stranger, like a stranger in my own hometown. I'm like a stranger, like a stranger in my own hometown. My so-called friends stop being friendly. Oh, but you can't keep a good man down. No, you can't keep him. I came home with good intentions about 5 or 6 years ago. I came home with good intentions about 5 or 6 years ago. Oh, my hometown won't accept me. I just don't feel welcome here no more. About 5 or 6 years ago, when my hometown won't accept me, just don't feel welcome here no more. I'm like a stranger in my hometown. Yeah, I'm like a stranger in my hometown.
Fantastic. We're at this big table in this wonderful rustic building where you eat your meals, and the phone rang and somebody just casually said, Muhammad, it's Elvis. And I thought, come on. Elvis who? You know, it was really Elvis Presley.
No, that fellow was joking.
Oh, no. I spoke to him.
Since we own television, we can't, because Elvis could hear about this.
Oh, no.
It wasn't real.
No, you know what he told me?
He wanted to impress you that I was a popular fellow.
No, Elvis called, and he told me, he put me on the phone with Elvis, and I talked, and Elvis said, I'm his number one fan. I didn't know that. Where did you meet him? In Las Vegas?
Las Vegas.
Yeah. He's quite a guy, isn't he?
Yeah.
Called from Memphis, and he said, I'm going to be opening in Las Vegas soon, and I talked to him about maybe coming on the show. He said, you have to talk to the colonel.
I'm telling you, that fellow was imposter. You wouldn't believe that was Elvis.
Oh, I know that was. Nobody could fool this ear when I heard that voice. I knew it was true.
Elvis used to love to sing late at night. You know, in Vegas, after we do the shows, we would go to his suite and we would sing gospel songs. And he was...
look at that. I thought that was a picture of you and me together when we first met them. Unless you would, Elvis is the colour of a leather couch I used to have.
Yeah,
that's a brown man.
Dogger.
Yeah, yeah. So you used to sit together and sing together?
Yeah. So he was... he didn't realise that we sang gospel songs in Wales, because I knew a lot of the songs that we were...
Yeah, because his idea, because he was, you know, obviously he was in the South that he was born and brought up. What did he think of the UK? What did he think of Wales? What was his idea of what Wales was like?
He was asking me about it. What was it like? And do people sing like I sing in Wales? And I said, well, they have big voices, but it's more traditional. The singing is more traditional there.
Did he ever talk about why he never came here, why he performed here? I guess that was Colonel Tom's thinking. But did he ever express an interest in coming to sing for his fans in the UK?
Yeah, he wanted to. And he was asking me what I thought it would be like for him to come here. And I said, you're Elvis Presley, for God's sake. I mean, you know, they'd love you to come to Britain. And he said, well, if I come there, will you show me around? And I said, well, I don't think I'll have to, but I will if you'd like.
Now, I met Elvis in 1970.
I got a thing that says, Elvis wants to meet you. I got to the Hilton Hotel, elevator opened up, and it was me, Liza Minnelli, Chubby Checker, and Linda Lovelace.
Wow.
What, you'd come together, or you just happened to be in that list?
No, he invited those four people
really? That
night. So we went up, and they searched us for guns, which was kind of silly, because there were guns everywhere once you got in. When he came in the room, he was Elvis. He wasn't the fat Elvis. He was Elvis. He was the guy. He goes, hey, man, you're the cat with a snake, ain't you? He said, yeah. And he goes, that's cool, man. I wish I would have thought of that. That's cool, man. He said, hey, I want to show you something. We go in the kitchen. He opens a drawer, takes out a loaded 38, snub-nosed 38, puts it in my hand. And he says, I'm going to show you how to take this gun out of somebody's hand.
A little devil's
here on my shoulder says, shoot him. A little angel over here says, don't kill him, just wound him. Okay. Before I could decide what to do, I was on the floor. And he's had his boot in my throat. I'm going, ha, it's good, Elvis. That's good.
I'm still reeling over the fact that you were there with Liza Minnelli.
Oh, yeah.
He must have thought you were sisters.
Well.
Of course, only three of us came down on the elevator that night. Now, I don't know what he did with Chubby Checker all night. I'll tell you what, he was an amazing character, very funny guy.
Wow.
But he was Elvis. Yeah. I mean, you know.
You know, as many times as we've talked on television and had interview situations, I've never asked you about Elvis.
What you want to know?
When did that all start? When did the whole love for Elvis begin?
He teases me about Elvis all the time.
But never says, on the air. Never.
No, well, he says, like, if Elvis was alive now, he says, man, you wouldn't even hang out with Elvis. I said, yes, I wish it, man. Elvis would be in the lobby of your house, like, say, man, is it there? And I would be in the room, going, hey, what's going on, man? He told me to come over. Well, I know what's going on. All right. But when I was a kid, see, Elvis Presley to me, it's his presence, I think it is. I don't think anyone in this business has had as much presence as Elvis. I don't think anyone's had as strong a presence. I think there have been I think Michael Jackson's the only entertainer who's ever been more famous than him. But I think Elvis has more presence. Like when Elvis walked in the room, everybody just looked at Elvis, you know? When he's on the screen, you looked at Elvis. He just had this thing about him. And he was going through all this stuff with drugs and all this craziness, but on screen and on stage, he always looked like he was in control. You know, and that's amazing because it was this war going on inside this guy. And I'm just fascinated with him, you know.
Do you see similarities in Elvis and Eddie Murphy?
None whatsoever.
Really?
Well, to start it off, Elvis is very white. And I'm very black. Elvis is from Memphis, and I've never been to Memphis. And had I gone back then, they probably would have... Elvis! I don't see any similarities. I just admire his presence, you know?
When I met Elvis with Led Zeppelin one evening in L.A.
Oh, that alone. Hold it. Let's pause for a minute. Let's just drink that in for a second.
Hey, we could do this all around the country, you know?
Ed McMahon here.
Yeah, well, Elvis wanted to know who was this. He'd adopted a kid when he was in the forces in Germany in 1959. Some sort of pen pal extremity thing, whatever it was. And this kid was a bit younger than the king himself and was into Zeppelin. And we were involved with some people around that time who were booking out Elvis too. And Elvis wanted to know who was this bunch of guys who was selling tickets quicker than him. And so they said, it's Led Zeppelin. And we went to see him two or three times. And a couple of times he made mistakes. And I remember that night at the Forum, he was doing something like Reconsider Baby or whatever, it was the Lowell Fulson song.
Yeah.
And he stopped it and he said, wait a minute, wait a minute. We've got Led Zeppelin in here tonight. We've got to get this right. And I went, I mean, so I mopped the tears away and we got the nod that we were going to meet him afterwards. And we went to the hotel and they had the entire top floor. No motorbikes or snakes. they just had these trestle tables with a couple of big guys. And they ushered us to a suite down the hall. It was a tacky place. It was great. It was all purples and browns and, you know.
He carried that with him, I believe.
Yeah, yeah. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. the room was filling up with sort of secondhand Anne Margaret's. Yeah. There was a lot of heads.
Well, you know, it has to be said, a secondhand Anne Margaret
there's
is still...
There's nothing wrong with that. Brilliant. And I was looking at Stella Stevens over the other side of the room and salivating. It was a fantastic build-up. And the hall, at the end of this huge suite, which was almost as big as this room, a door kept opening and somebody kept popping their head around, just waiting for the temperature of the room and enough cosmetic to join the atmosphere so that it was getting a bit sort of feral. And then the door opened and this guy came through the door and I just, my heart jumped. It was like, whoa, look at the way he moves. And I mean, he was just going around chairs like. He was so, so, so cool. And he came over to us and we stood in a circle for about 2 or 3 hours talking. And people kept coming by from his retinue, from his entourage, yeah, thinking that he had enough. And he was going, no. We had a great conversation. And our manager, Led Zeppelin's manager, Peter Grant, is sort of quite well known as probably as much as John Paul Jones, you know, big guy. A very great presence about him, and Peter was just going past us on the way to taking a seat somewhere in the homage area.
Yeah. the second circle.
That's right, yeah. And he lost his foot in a bit like our friend there, and he 350 pounds of joy ended up on Vernon Presley's lap. On it. And Elvis's dad was really frail, with a white safari top. And we talked with Presley for about three hours. It just went on and on and on. We were talking about the root and your question about where did it come from. It came from him and he still got it. He still was into that whole Delta thing. He, you know, good rocking tonight. All that stuff that got him going in the first place. But he also knew, and he had a great sense of humor, and he knew that he was locked in this self-parody. I mean...
Because you were in Vegas... in the absolute heyday of Vegas,
oh, yes,
weren't you?
Yes.
When did you do? When did the Elvis incident happen? When was that? Was that?
Oh, when Elvis made the first time or the second time he was in Vegas, and I had a jumpsuit and it was open to there. A few bar.
Dame
a few
Shirley.
Oh, I wasn't Dame then. I was a top. I was a top, and we were talking, and I was talking actually. rabbit, and he was doodling down my front, and I didn't realize until he got to there, and with incredible sensation.
what was he doodling with, Dame Shirley?
Well, he said it was a biro. it was a bishop. And When I went to bed that night, alone, I took off my jumpsuit, and there was this doodle all the way down. And I just went to bed, and I said, I'm not going to wash.
You were a very good friend with Elvis, weren't you?
I loved him. I loved the man. You know, when the first time I ever met him, he came to see my show. He came to see my show first before I saw him. And believe me, it took me a good 10 minutes to quieten the audience down once I introduced him. He stood up and he had a cape on, and he opened this cape up as he stood in the booth in Las Vegas with his cape open, you know, like Batman. And the audience went absolutely berserk. And I said, shh, this is my show. No, I couldn't quieten them down, not for 10 minutes. So I brought out some of my big gun songs, you know, to try and quieten them, which I did in the end. And he came backstage and he said, what a hell of a show. Thank you very much. And thank you for your this is how
humble he was. He says, thank you for introducing me. He said,
wow.
Elvis, you know. I said, Elvis, I can't tell you how I thank you for being in my show. You know, that's number one.
We went to work for Elvis Presley for 5 weeks, and it was wonderful. He was wonderful. I loved him. He was such a gentleman and all that to me, you know.
Tell me about that. Tell me.
Well, when they first called, the girl said, Elvis Presley, oh, my God, what are we going to do? I said, hey, it's a gig, and it's a good one.
Uh-huh.
So we went, and when we got there, it was nothing like what we might have thought, you know, because it was just wonderful. Cool. It was really wonderful. He was into gospel, so every once in a while when we finished rehearsing with him, we just sing gospel, all of us, you know, and we just had a good time. People said he was prejudiced. I said, well, I never felt his prejudice, and I don't think he was prejudiced. You know,
he treated everyone
the same. The same.
People have, you know, certain stereotypes about him.
I think so.
Yeah.
Because he was a wonderful person, so good looking, you just didn't want to even look nowhere else. He was so handsome, but he was just as nice, fun. You know, he cracked jokes and all that kind of crap, and he'd be singing, and he'd make you laugh and whatnot. So... we had a good time.
The time you met Elvis Presley.
Elvis Presley.
This I thought was lovely. This is a great story.
This would have, you know, I was, it was about 1972, so I was not famous, you know, and I was working in Vegas, opening for Ann Margaret, you know, and they knew each other. They had worked together.
Right.
And I thank Ann Margaret and her husband, Roger Smith, for hiring me because I had a weird act. And
like what kind of stuff were you doing?
Well, I'll show you. This was one of my bits. Like, I had sort of a like a funny magic act. And I'd bow, and I'd, you know, thank you. And following Ann Margaret in the next week was Elvis Presley, and he came in to see the show that night. And so now the show's over, and we're all in our dressing rooms afterwards, and I look down the hall, and I see this beautiful woman coming down the hall, and it's Priscilla,
oh, yes,
his wife. And she sort of, I have no idea, it's Priscilla. Anyway, she peels away, and then there's Elvis, and he's all in white with this black hair, and he's got that huge, this is the thin Elvis, by the way. He looks great. And he's got this beautiful diamond buckle, you know, that celebrates his appearances at the Hilton Hotel. And he walks by... He walks by me, and he sees me, and I'm kind of like this, and he says, son, you have an oblique sense of humor.
Oblique.
Now, the first time I met Elvis, I was in Las Vegas in the 70s. I was the conductor and music director for B.B. King, the blues act. We were opening in the Las Vegas Hilton's main room, as the opening act for Ann Margaret. Well, we had no idea Elvis was there, nor did she, so we were watching her act from backstage, and in her act, she walked around the main room in the audience, and she always stopped at this certain table. Well, there was this guy at the table, the maitre d' knew, with his hat pulled down over his head, and it was a gray fedora with a black band. And when she stopped there, she looked down to say something, and he pulled his hat back, and she almost fainted because it was Elvis Presley. Well, after the show, I was downstairs in B.B.'s dressing room with his nephew, Ann Margaret's backup singers, Hodges, James, and Smith. Always sounded like a law firm. Sonny Turner, who was the lead vocalist of the Checkmates, and his girlfriend. And Elvis came bounding in. And he was coming to see B.B., but B.B. wasn't there. So he ran into us. And he introduced himself as if it was needed. I had been determined not to like Elvis Presley coming from Memphis because I heard about everything he ever did. And I was like, he's just showing off, you know. Hey, you know, you don't have to do that stuff. So his magnetism shone through that particular night, because when he came in the door, he thrust his arm, "Hi, I'm Elvis Presley," and my arm just automatically went up and shook his hand. And I was like, this is not happening to me. And I introduced myself and told him I was from Memphis, and he was like, "Nah, you're not from Memphis. If you're from Memphis, where do I buy my clothes?" And we started talking about Lansky Brothers on Beale Street and about things that were native Memphis. And he was like, "Oh, you are from Memphis." And so everybody, you know, introduced themselves. And he told one of the entourage, said, "Take him upstairs, and I'll be up in a minute." And he went to see Ann Margaret about 30 minutes later. We're in the suite on the 30th floor. And in comes Elvis. He's back in.
Opened up a lot of doors for me to get through. Elvis was a pioneer, and he came out 1 year before I did. He was out in 55, mm-hmm. Heartbreak Hotel. And then I come in 56. And Elvis and I were very good friends up until the last minute of his bodily life. But he'll always live because of the fact he was such a beautiful man. I don't care what nobody's saying. I know Elvis. You know, there are a lot of rumors. Elvis and I sang spiritual together. And he kept me from being number one. I was number one soul, and he was number one world, and it took a long time, but it's almost like the two rental cars. Uh-huh. It made me try harder, and I love Elvis for it, and we'll always pray for Elvis.
And one of Elvis's guys would come and get me and at night and take me to Graceland. When I was at the Sands Hotel by myself, and this was before he started, in Vegas. And Elvis in those days was really kind of the Howard Hughes of rock and roll. Nobody ever saw him. He wasn't doing shows. He was just hung up doing all those movies. I used to do a thing in my show where I would do a thing about Elvis. I just won't tell you my, and I never understood a word he was saying, and his boys beat me on him. And so I'm at the Sands Hotel. I'd understand this is like in 68, you know, Vegas was a whole different deal. And Maynard D is about 80 years old, and he brings me a note about 10 minutes after I'd done this Elvis thing, and the note says, "He's here." I said, "Well, who's here?" I said, "Because Elvis is never anywhere." I said, "I suppose Elvis Presley's here." And from the back of the room, Elvis jumps up and starts singing something. And the lights went up, and the place went, without exaggeration, went up. It took me about 20 minutes just to get him back. And so a couple of times he came into Vegas to see me. Then when he opened at the International, I had finished up my run in Vegas at the Sands Hotel, and I ended up over where Elvis was. Because Elvis would go on at 8, I'd go on at 10, Elvis had gone at 12, and I'd gone at 2. And I'm doing my 10 o'clock show, and Elvis was walking, you know, back through the kitchens and the stuff, and he walks past my showroom. And I'm on stage, and when you're on stage, it's like you're in your living room at night. And if somebody walks in, it's really kind of startling. You know where everybody is, and there's some rustling from the side. And here comes Elvis Presley, and about four of his bodyguard, four of the Memphis guys. And he just walks by me and hits me on the arm, says, "Hi, Bill," and keeps on going. And obviously the crowd just wigs out. Now, and I don't say anything. And he just walks off, and now I'm doing my 2 o'clock show, and in those days, the town was small enough that everybody in town knew that Elvis Presley walked on stage with Bill Medley. So that there was lines to get in my show, like he's going to do it again. So the show starts, and I'm doing "Loving You," and I'm right at the baby, I get down on, you know, and here he comes again. Here he comes again, and he walks by, hits me, "Hi, Bill," and they all now hit me. And now he had like 8 of his Memphis guys and about 10 of the security guys at the hotel. and they all walk by her room. And I'm, if you, you know, lonely, love me, lucky, and I'm trying to do the song. And so finally I get done. The place, I mean, people are throwing babies out of windows. I mean, they are literally going nuts because that's what they were and didn't think they were going to see it. But just waited, and they finally calmed down. I said, okay, I don't know who he is, but now he's starting to piss me off. And Elvis heard I said that, and he called my dresser. He said, Bill, I hope I wasn't messing up. I said, are you kidding me? I said, my next show's at 8 o'clock. Could you be there, please? And he was a really really good guy. And the great thing was is that, like, when he would be getting ready for his midnight show, and I would be sitting in my dressing room, he would call a lot of times and say, Bill, come down to the dressing room. And I would go down, and it would be just Elvis and his hairdresser. And he would send all the boys up to get in their positions. And so I would, you know, Elvis and I would sit there, I don't know, probably 40, 50 times, just sit, him and I. So I really got to know Elvis, not, you know, the Elvis Presley. We really had some great one-on-one time. Band starts that 2000 thing. Boom. And oh, even now, and the women are screaming, and I'm like, jeez. The emotion and it just got like, it was nuts. And they were starting to, you know, fix him up a little bit, make sure he's in. And so I backed away a little bit, about 10 feet. And they're getting him ready, and he, you know, he's, you know, looking over me and, you know, saying, you're all right. And boy, and the kid, and it was the first time I saw him from about 12 feet away in the shadows with that band playing that 2000 and the girl screaming. I said, holy criminy, that's Elvis Presley. You know, I got so comfortable with him that that's I got so excited I almost went on.
A little birdie told me that when you were a little girl, you actually met Elvis.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you remember that? Do you remember?
It wasn't actually, you don't really meet Elvis. Uh-huh. You actually just look at Elvis. Okay. My mother sang with Elvis for years.
Yeah.
She and her group, they were called the Sweet Inspirations. Yeah. They also sang for Aretha for many, many years. On most of the, in the 60s, uh-huh. They were on all of Aretha songs. Well, Elvis took a liking to them. Mm-hmm. And my mom sang with him for many years. And they were very close.
Yeah.
I just remember at one point being in a room, and we were all in this room, my mother and the singers, and we, you know, the usually backstage kind of thing, and he just walks in the room with his mink on, with his glasses on.
Oh, my God.
And he just walks in, he says something, and everybody just, you don't say anything, you just look. It was just one of those moments I won't forget as a kid.
Oh, my God.
It wasn't like, hi, Mr. Elvis, nice to meet you. You didn't do that. You just sat back and just looked at him.
Amazing.
It was amazing, amazing to look at.
Yeah.
Just amazing.
Wow.
And just to be in his presence was awesome.
Ralph, that in 1976, in Elvis Presley's last appearance at the Las Vegas Hilton, by his bed he had a little notepad, and he wrote some words down. He wrote actually kind of a message to God and to himself, and crumpled it up and threw it in a waste paper can, and one of his guys evidently retrieved it, kept it. About 7 or 8 months ago, this note showed up in a Sotheby auction sale, and some people call me knowing of my friendship with Elvis. And when I heard what the note said, it just tore my heart out, and I bought it. Somehow that got out, and Elvis fans from around the world started to write me wanting copies of this letter, of this note. So that's when we decided to write a song around it. And so we did. So that's the story of the letter.
All right, with the exception of what was in the letter.
I'm paraphrasing, of course, but it said, I'm finally alone. I'm glad they're all gone now. I probably won't rest tonight. I have no need for all of this. Help me, Lord. I think he was addressing his loneliness. He had, by that time, become quite a recluse. And
you knew him rather well, didn't you?
We were very close friends. Well, toward the end, we had quite a conversation one night in his dressing room, where he talked about his loneliness, his love for his daughter, the fact that he felt for him it was pretty much over. The conversation went on about 2 hours, and he was very troubled.
You mean he was prophesying his own death?
I believe that, yes. I mean, in retrospect, I didn't realize it then necessarily, but certainly in retrospect.
This song I'm dedicating to a really good friend of mine who have passed on, one of the greatest entertainers ever alive, one of them. He was the king. This song called Tupelo, that was his hometown, to Mr. Elvis, president, who has passed on. That was his favorite. I hope whatever he added, he's resting in ease. Below Mississippi. There were Abbott was born. Abbott Presley. One of the greatest people ever been born. The rock and roll king. That was my home too. Right down below. In Clarksdale. Tupelo is gone. Tupelo is gone. It got destroyed by the rain.